Tom, as an educator and a mere mortal mother of a student with disabilities, I thank you for your decades of service to the profession. Now, I am tempted to give you a pop quiz right now to see if you remember anything from the first hour we spent together this morning, now that your head is full of amazing ideas from my colleagues, but I am not gonna do that, but I hope you're getting a taste of how fun it is to be here, just what the learning is like for everybody who gets to be here. I'm having great fun listening to my colleagues. What I'm gonna do instead is I'm gonna try to persuade you that task is an incredibly powerful thing to focus on when it comes to learning. So I'm gonna give you one big idea, two principles, and three questions. Here's the big idea. When you think about what is at the heart of learning, think about that word heart for a second. Those of you who know Latin or one of the languages derived from Latin know that the word core comes from the word for heart, el corazón, la cour. Okay, the word core and the word heart are connected. So what is at the heart of learning? When I think about that, I think about the instructional core. See a little picture of it up there? The interaction of teachers, students, and content. What's actually going on in classrooms and learning environments? And right at the center of that sits task. So we're gonna focus on this big idea that at the heart of learning, at the core, is task. Here are the two principles. Maybe. There's task. All right, here are the two principles. My colleagues, Richard Elmore, Lee Title, Sarah Fireman, and I wrote a book in which we talked about seven principles of the instructional core. I'm just gonna focus on the two that are related to task. You see them up here. Principle four is task predicts performance. So we started off our 8x8s here with Andrew showing you a lot of performance data from all over the United States. Now, this is the kind of time of year where in the United States, lots of educators and parents are kind of anxiously awaiting those test scores coming back. Comes back sometime in the summer, maybe even right about now. We're kind of waiting to see those test scores as a mark of how do we do with performance. This is, of course, directly tied to what Rick was talking about focusing on achievement, right? But you don't actually have to wait for your test scores to come back, or if you're focused on other performance metrics, like caring, for example, you don't have to wait for your survey to come back to tell you about your caring or your executive function. You could just look at the tasks that students are asked to do in classrooms, and you'd be able to make a very fair prediction of what students would be able to do. Because the thing is, on most days, most kids will try to do what we ask them to do. Sometimes when I'm in schools, I really wish they wouldn't, because we're not asking them to do things that are worth doing. I kind of wish they would stand up on the table and say, no, I'm not gonna do this stupid task. But they don't. They actually, pretty much, most students on most days will try to do what we ask them to do. And what that means is that task is a great predictor of performance. Now, as you've heard from some of my colleagues, and you know from your own experience, some kids come with more than what the task asked of them. They have more skill already, they have more interest in what the task is, and they bring that and they can perform above the task. But if we just think about what will being at school do for you, we know that if you look at the task, it's gonna predict performance. Now the second principle, the real accountability is in the task we ask students to do, kind of turns on its head some of the accountability we've had here in the United States, and unfortunately some countries in the world have followed us on this one, which is to think about accountability as external. What are external agencies demanding of schools? How are they saying we're successful or not? So we tend to think about accountability as something that's coming from outside of schools. But that's actually not the way kids experience it in schools. That's not the way students experience it. The way students experience it is, what is my teacher asking me to do? And you can tell this when you listen in classrooms to the questions kids ask. They ask questions like, do we have to write in pen or pencil on this? Well, wait, can I do it on the computer or do I have to do it by hand? Wait, how long is that supposed to be? When you hear those kinds of questions, you know the kids are very smart. They know what I need to do is do this task in the way that the teacher imagines it should be done. And if I do that, I'm much more likely to be successful. And by the way, you hear this, these kinds of questions not just in K-12 schools, but also in graduate schools of education. So, these two principles together tell us that, whoa, task is an incredibly powerful lever, because if it's gonna predict what kind of performance we're gonna have and kids are gonna feel accountable for them, we should really focus on task as an incredibly powerful lever for learning. All right, so that brings us to the three questions. How do you do that? So when I spend time in schools and time in classrooms and learning environments, I try to ask several questions about tasks. Now, being a Harvard faculty member, I'm giving you 5 questions, but I'm only going to talk about 3 for time. All right, so here are the 3 in blue. The first one seems easy, but it's a little harder than it seems, which is, what is the actual work that students are being asked to do? Not the objective that's written on the board, not the thing the teacher said out loud we're trying to do today, not the thing you imagine might be coming later in this lesson. But when you look down at the desk, which is where the task often is, or you just look at what students are doing, how would you describe what they're actually being asked to do? That answer gives you that evidentiary basis on which you can have a real conversation, a real analysis of the task. The second question directly relates to that 4th principle. It's a prediction question. If you were a student and you did this task, what would you know and be able to do? So assume success. What would you know and be able to do? And again, some kids might be able to do more than what the task asks them to do, but let's just establish what's the ceiling of performance we would expect just from being here in this classroom today. What would this task let you know and be able to do? Now, the final question that I invite you to think about is somewhat related to what Tom was just saying, which is, what's the distribution of performance of students on this task? Now, I'm not saying students with disabilities are the source of the distribution. What I'm saying is we know that learners are wildly different. Some of them have visible disabilities. Some of them have less visible disabilities. They all are wildly different. And so usually you see some distribution of performance on a task. Maybe all of them can do the task, maybe all of them can't, but more often than not, you'll see some distribution. You want to pay attention to that distribution because it's giving you a lot of information about who needs what kind of challenge and support to move to the next level in their learning. So, basic idea is if you ask these 3 questions, you're going to get a really rich understanding not only of what's being asked of students and what you would expect them to be able to do, but what kinds of things we need to do in order to close the gap between our aspiration for what kids should know and be able to do and what we would actually expect from them being in school. So with that, I invite you to just think about this one big idea, the core, the heart of learning, task at the center of that, these 2 principles, task predicts performance and the real accountability system is in the tasks we ask students to do, and these 3 questions. And I invite you to talk about them with other people because you'll find that you don't answer the questions the same way, and it's in discussing them that you begin to reach common understanding about what is it we would want for students in terms of learning, how close are we, and what do we need to do to get students there. Thank you and have a great year.